So, any ideas of what we're talking about when we say learning to learn skills? Any thoughts? So if you have a student come into your classroom and their parents maybe told you on an initial interview they have all kinds of skills, they can label everything, they have lots and lots of words, sometimes they don't really engage with other people, and you have them come into your classroom and they'll hang out with you and they might go with the flow of the classroom, but they're not looking at you, they don't look at other kids. How did you learn your first swear word? You heard it, you saw it. Okay, so you were looking at other people. You were seeing that they were getting attention, they were getting people to laugh, maybe they were controlling other people. But you saw those things and you imitated those things so that you could get the same reaction. I grew up with two older brothers, so I had a nice vernacular when I was pretty young on how to hang with the older kids. Surprisingly, good thing my parents raised us fairly well that it wasn't extreme and I knew the context where to use it. But we have some learners that don't know the context, right? So they might imitate a little bit, but they don't know the appropriate context. Okay, so imitation is a great learning to learn skills, a learning to learn skill. This is where we see typical learners using or learning from their environment. How about following directions? Something we take for granted, right? If you say stand up, most of the kids in your class will stand up. Some of them need prompts. What about you holding up materials and having everyone, okay, so I have this up here, assuming everyone's looking at the presentation behind me, joint attention. That's another learning to learn skill that we really want our learners to have in their repertoire so that they can learn naturally from their environment and we don't have to sit at the table with M&Ms and teach them or some other form of reinforcement. We want them to learn naturally from their environment so we don't have to spend as much time explicitly teaching them every word used. I looked up when I was completing this presentation and just kind of prepping, a child at age 3, neurotypical child at age 3, will use 200 different words a day. Not altogether, but 200 different words on average. So if you think about learners on the autism spectrum, or even those with communication delays, language delays, they're hardly using 3 words. Some of you might have learners that emit 25 words, but they might be 6 years old. I have some learners, they're 9 years old, and they're only emitting 3 words, or 3 utterances. So our job is to test these kids, see where they are, and prioritize with the time that we have with them so that we can make their lives better. And not only their lives, families' lives, your instructional assistants' lives, everyone in their community, we want to make their lives better. So the point of this is so that you have a system so that you can really efficiently program for these learners, okay? All right, so we talked about briefly the verbal operants, the manned and the tact. And the verbal operants are B.F. Skinner's. He wrote a book in the 50s, and it was called Verbal Behavior. And what Skinner did is he really had a lot of thoughts. It's a very thick book, rather intense, but he's a brilliant man. I think you would have to spend years in reading it and taking notes to really understand everything he was going for. And a lot of people in the field have really broken it down, and the point of me bringing it up is so that you understand the basis of verbal behavior. So the point of using the analysis of verbal behavior is so that we can explicitly teach learners on the autism spectrum or those with language delays that don't naturally learn from their environment. So from imitation, from following directions, from hearing other people, and those who have different motivation systems. So what he did was he broke down our use of language into verbal operants, and they're parts of language based on function. And when I say language, what Skinner was referring to is the things that we are doing that involve a listener and a speaker. So we're communicating something between a listener and a speaker, and they're learned from environmental events. So what we do as professionals is we look at what occurs before a response and after a response, not only to see what it is, what that response is in regard to a function or a verbal operant, but so that, again, we can see deficiencies in our learners and we can explicitly teach them. So what this is here, it's hard to see. Actually, if you have the slides printed out per page, it's probably easier to see. I try to use a pentagon to show that in order for us to spontaneously communicate about any given word or concept, we have to acquire using or master using this word across all different functions of language that Skinner was talking about in his book. So the four elementary or basic verbal operants that Skinner talked about were manned, tact, interverbal, and echoic. And I have them up here on this slide just to kind of break them down quickly. Again, our goal is so that our learners are spontaneously communicating with others. So the first thing that we want to think about is, let's use the example of juice. What are the ages of the students that are in your classrooms? Is it mostly elementary and preschool? Is there middle school? Perfect. High school? Perfect. Not to say you can't use this for those that are in middle school. I have some learners that are 13, 14, that we might use the analysis of verbal behavior and the VB-MAPP just to see where their communication deficiencies lie. But the VB-MAPP has, it's based on, and we'll talk about it in a few minutes, it's based on skills from 0 to 4 years of age. Really those splinter communication skills. So I use juice as an example because we see learners preschool, elementary school, really having motivation for juice. Juice is kind of a regular thing. Juice, cookies, crackers. So if you think about if your learner's thirsty and they're emitting challenging behavior, you might say, how do I know that they're thirsty? Well, maybe they were just eating popcorn or some chips, some salty foods, right? It sets up motivation for wanting something to drink. So if they're emitting problem behavior and they're not saying to you juice or duh or exchanging a picture symbol, by the way, just to get this other important detail out about verbal behavior isn't necessarily vocal. It doesn't need to be spoken. It doesn't matter the form of the response, it matters the function. So it can be a sign, it can be a picture exchange, can be pressing a button on a communication device, okay? The earliest of learners might just be a reach for something. So it doesn't matter if it's spoken or not. However, one of these verbal operants we'll talk about in a minute does need to be spoken. And if your learner has a condition called apraxia, how many, I know you speech therapists probably know what apraxia is. Have you teachers, would you like a quick overview of apraxia from one of our speech therapists? Okay. Well, just a quick overview. It's for those of you who aren't sure what apraxia is, it's just poor planning, a neurological condition where you have poor connections in your brain between your oral motor and your language centers. Is that a quick overview? Okay. So if you have a learner with apraxia, they're not going to be able to easily emit vocalization. So one exception up here we'll talk about is an echoic. But for the most part, it doesn't matter the form when we're talking about verbal. Okay, so that being said, let's think about juice. So in order for Tommy to spontaneously communicate with any one of you or his parents regarding juice, he has to be able to master juice as a mand. So let's talk about the mand quickly. The mand is, yes, it's a request, but the reason Skinner called it a mand and not just a request is because it really does involve going to a communicative partner. So I have motivation, let's assume this is juice. I have motivation for juice because I just had a really long ride. I was rushing this morning. I didn't get a chance to drink anything. I had like dry toast in the car, really thirsty. And I have this motivation, right? So in order for me to completely call it a man, I have to go to you. I have to get your attention. I have to have the motivation. And then I have to be able to produce something that communicates juice to you. Whether it's, is this the sign for juice? Juice, whether